Cheatgrass is an invasive annual that has changed the landscape of much of Western North America, but not for the best. For a long time, it was thought the elevation in our state was too high for this weed to be much of a problem. But conditions have changed. Rangeland managers fear it will spread to and take over habitats here. University of Wyoming assistant professor in the plant sciences department, Brian Mealor and Leslie Wegener, dig into this subject.
Just quickly, what is cheatgrass?
Cheatgrass is kind of an anomaly in some ways because it's an introduced species to our region. It originated in Eurasia, and so it doesn't really belong here if we want to look back in a historical perspective. Biologically, it's an annual grass, which means it grows for 1 year and then produces seed. Ah. It doesn't produce a big root structure that allows it to persist from roots and grow back every year. So seed production is really its main goal in life. The more seeds that it produces, the higher probability that it has of persisting as a population.
Well, how then did it get to our area?
So that's open for debate somewhat. There are a lot of historical records that a number of folks have looked into about how it may have potentially been introduced into the U.S. Some of the prevailing hypotheses are that it was a contaminant in wheat seed. So when people were settling, particularly in the Pacific Northwest, they would have brought wheat seed with them from their home in Europe, and then it maybe was a contaminant there. Another way that is somewhat interesting is before we had packing peanuts to pack our dishes in, people would pack dishes and fragile items in straw.
Yeah.
And that potentially it was introduced. There were some seeds or even the straw, such as you see here, was used to pack grandmother's dishes from Russia or somewhere. Mm. And when they brought them over, then seeds contaminated the straw and it was released as a contaminant in the U.S.
And so what's the problem with this cheatgrass?
Primarily, we think of it as a weed problem. To me, a weed is a plant that interferes with your management objectives. And it's a little bit more complicated with something like cheatgrass. It's not just a weed that we might think of as something like dandelion. To me, it goes broader than a simple weed problem. With it being an annual grass that grows, actually germinates oftentimes in the fall. So we'll have germination now.
Okay.
It will overwinter as a little seedling or a rosette with just small leaves. And then it's able to use up moisture early in the spring as the snow is melting, that some of our, essentially preemptively, so that some of our native perennial grasses can't use that water.
Mm-hmm.
And so from that characteristic, it has a competitive advantage over some of the natives. The associated damage that comes along with that is that it grows quickly and it dries up very quickly. And in locations where it dries up, in places that are important habitat for some wildlife, such as sage grouse, where sagebrush is an important issue, it creates a continuous fuel underneath the sagebrush that is very susceptible to fire by lightning strikes or somebody flicking a cigarette out of a car as they drive down the road.
Yeah.
It can change the way that fire works in those systems then, because we did not necessarily have that continuous fuel. We may have fires that burn more frequently than we had in the past.
Okay.
Depending on who we ask, some literature says that fire return intervals in sagebrush grasslands may have been as long as 150 to 300 years in between wildfires, historically. There are some areas where cheatgrass has become a problem that have burned maybe now every once every 3 to 5 years instead of 150
difference.
To 300 years. It is.
So how bad of a problem is it here in Wyoming?
I would say increasing in Wyoming. The primary area of concern since its introduction into the western United States has been the Great Basin region. So northern Nevada, Oregon, Washington, Idaho, Utah.
Mm-hmm.
Their sagebrush systems are somewhat different than we have here. There's more bare ground between their sagebrush. And there is hypothesized that there is a shorter evolutionary history of grazing animals.
Okay.
So with some mismanaged grazing at the turn of the century, it may have potentially made that system more susceptible to cheatgrass invasion. We've had it in Wyoming since the early 1900s. It's been present in the state for a long time, but we think that with the prolonged drought in the early 2000s, that may have potentially increased its presence and problems in our systems.
Who all is being affected by this problem?
So it can potentially affect anybody. If you think about direct impacts, as far as a plant that is decent food for livestock early in the year, but as it turns purple and then turns brown, the forage quantity and quality of cheatgrass diminishes quickly. Mm-hmm. So in some years, unlike this year where we've had a good moisture year all year, in some years it may really serve as a forage source for both livestock and wildlife for a few weeks. Mm. Whereas many of our perennial grasses may stay green for a long period of the summer if we have moisture.
Right.
So it can affect anything that depends on plants as a forage and the economies that depend on that as well.
So what are you and your students doing about this problem?
So we've got a lot of different work going on a number of sort of paths. Everything from pretty basic experiments trying to determine which types of control methods work. Mm. So I think every year for the last 5 years we have put out some kind of evaluation of different herbicides to see which herbicide might control cheatgrass without harming the desirable species that we want.
Oh.
And we're finding some things that work well and some that don't work very well.
What's kind of an innovative way do you think that you're looking at?
We have one study in our research group that a graduate student is working on in areas where cheatgrass is already established, and that's seeing which animals will consume it at the right time and potentially diminish seed production through grazing.
Hmm.
So we have sheep and we have cows, and we have sheep and cows together, and they're grazing in the spring and fall and also in spring and fall to determine if we can use grazing as a tool and separate from using chemical means like herbicides to diminish the cheatgrass populations in areas where it's already established. Now, in some areas of Wyoming, we don't really have much of a cheatgrass population yet.
Hmm.
And so we talk about preventing weed invasions in general a lot, but we really don't know the best ways to do that.
Hmm.
And unfortunately, some of those areas where we don't have a lot of cheatgrass, we have a lot of oil and gas development, or we have people building roads, or we have fires. And a typical management approach after a lot of those disturbances is to come back and reseed desirable grasses into those areas. Now, unfortunately, Wyoming state law allows for up to 1,200 cheatgrass seeds per pound of seed that you buy.
That's a lot.
Included in the seed that you're going to plant out. So we may be unintentionally planting cheatgrass seed when we plant desirable seed to reclaim these areas.
In areas where it hasn't been before.
So it's a high priority to keep it out of those areas. So we have another project going, one of my students that's working on understanding germination characteristics of cheatgrass, how it differs from some of those perennial grasses that we want to keep on sites, and then capitalizing on some of those differences to remove cheatgrass from the reclamation seed that we might be planting.
Okay.
So we're trying different things such as temperature of germination, timing of exposure to water, how long do they dry after we do some kind of treatment.
Yeah.
And our hope is that if we can develop a process to remove cheatgrass from reclamation seed, that we will not have to further take steps once it's been introduced to come back and control it.
Good. Well, thank you, Brian. Very interesting.
You're welcome.